Our text today is this 13th chapter of the book of Joshua. And the Lord said unto Joshua, Thou art old and stricken in years, and there remaineth yet very much land to be possessed. The assignment set before the man Joshua was twofold. He was to conquer the land of Canaan and divide it among his people. In a brilliant series of battles, Joshua conquered the Canaanites in the south and then in the north. At the end of a 7 years' war, the land of Canaan, for the most part, was in Israel's possession. This chapter now begins the second part and the last half of Joshua's assignment, to divide the land among the people. This part of the book is not quite so exciting. Nothing here to compare to the crossing over of Jordan at flood stage, or the fall of the fortress city of Jericho, or the daring gamble of the Gibeonites, or the day that the sun stood still. These chapters are filled with a lot of dry geographical details. But they are important. And in an odd sort of way, I think you will find them interesting. The chapter begins when the Lord says to Joshua, You are old, well advanced in years, and there yet remaineth much of the land to be possessed. Joshua, you may remember, was one out of only two men who saw this adventure from the start to the finish. Joshua was born as a slave in the land of Goshen, journeyed with Moses on his 40-year march through the wilderness. And when Moses was left behind, the reins of leadership fell into his hands. Like the good soldier that he was, Joshua did that which was his duty to do. He crossed over Jordan and engaged the Canaanites in combat. But the years had taken their toll on him. Time was running out. True, much of the land of Canaan still remained to be conquered. The nations were still entrenched in the south toward Egypt. All along the seacoast, across the mountain range of Lebanon, the Canaanite nations had dug in and were waiting. Much remained to be done, and now Joshua was old. To us, that seems like a depressing thought. No matter how long we live, no matter how much we do, no matter how much we accomplish, there always seems so much left for us still to do. Loose ends that we want to tie up. Finishing touches that we want to put upon a project. And the genuine interest we have in wanting to see how things turn out with our children or with our grandchildren. Our days looking back on them pass so swiftly. The bright morning hours of youth, the long afternoon, and then before you know it, the evening shadows are lengthening above our heads. And we are reminded that our strength has its limits. Our days are numbered. How many times standing in a cemetery over the grave of a loved one haven't we regretted the golden opportunities that we missed and then longed for another chance because there's so much still we want to do? But don't you see? God is not putting Joshua down when he says that. This is not a complaint. A bad mark from God against Joshua for failure. Joshua couldn't do it all. God never intended that any one of you should. God expects nobody to do what only God can do, and that's finish a thing. Nor does he demand one of us to live beyond our day. It comes a time, you know, when finally we must repose our anxious minds and our restless hands into the everlasting arms of our Father. And what then of all the unfinished business of life, the uncompleted projects? God will find him other hands to carry on. He is not limited to any one instrument. The workers change, but the work of God goes on. The emphasis here is on something else. You are old, Joshua. Much land remains to be conquered, it is true. But now you divide the land for an inheritance to Israel, as I commanded you. The military campaign was over, but now the people faced a new problem. The difficult task of establishing themselves as a nation. Defeating an enemy doesn't make you a nation. Joshua was more than to conquer and destroy. Joshua also was to build and to plant. The military campaign ended with success. But Joshua was not discharged because he had done one job well. In fact, he would need even more strength and courage and wisdom for dividing the land among the people. War does not solve problems. In many ways, war multiplies the problem. After a war, the greedy nations rush in, taking selfish advantage of the beaten. And when the dust settles, you sometimes wonder why the war was ever fought at all. The seeds of the Second World War were sown at the peace table at the end of the First World War. Our own civil war did not cease when the last rifle shot was heard in the South. It wore on for years in the terrible days of Reconstruction. And you men who have come back from military combat can tell us that's a hard thing to do, to fit back into society. To find your niche in an era of peace when all you've been doing is fighting and killing. Joshua's task now is to teach his people to hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. It is an easy thing for a teacher to complain about the ignorance and apathy of students in front of him. It's a darn hard thing to teach that ignorance and apathy out of them. Any nitwit can point to the breakdown of family life in America today. The hard thing is to build a single home in America today. Children can tell you about the greedy selfishness at work in our society. The hard thing is to live your life of going against the stream, spending yourself, pouring out yourself in service to others. It can happen, it has happened, that you can win the battle and lose the peace. A man can slay all of the dragons out there, fight and win for his country and in his career. And find out then too late that his wife doesn't even know him. His children are total strangers to him. And his home is nothing but a richly furnished house. Oh, that's a tragic victory. Aren't they? To build. The easy thing to tear down and destroy. Joshua's job now is to divide the land among the 12 tribes. They all fought and they all marched, and now they should all share in the spoil. But the tribes were different in size and strength and speciality. Some were strong and some were weak. Some were large, others smaller. The old tribal jealousies would begin to rear their ugly heads. Suspicions, prejudices of long standing. And the reason the Lord's on Joshua is do it now before you die. Now don't let the people later on say, I wonder what Joshua intended. Oh, he would have wanted me to have the section of land over here. Many times when a person of means passes away, he neglects to tell his heirs what he wanted done. He might as well have told them to start quarreling and squabbling over the inheritance. It is an act of courage and of faith to set your house in order before you die. Think of Father Jacob on his deathbed. His 12 sons gathered around him. Knowing their traits and their tendencies, their temperament and their individual talents. And then he told them, Reuben, my boy, my firstborn, you are unstable as water. Unable to control your sexual passions, you can't control anything else either. Simeon and Levi, two peas in a pod. A streak of cruelty runs in the blood of your bull. Now that seems harsh to us. But the old man told his sons to their face, what's what? And there would be no debate about it when the old man was gone. That's Joshua's job. Settle it now. And the first four tribes are exceptions. Long ago when Israel came out of the desert to the land east of Jordan, three tribes, Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh, asked for that land east of Jordan to be their inheritance. They were the cattlemen and the herdsmen of Israel. The wide open spaces, the roomy rangeland, the good grazing ground, the watering holes were ideally suited to them. And the other tribes, the merchant tribes, the craftsmen and the farmers, they didn't care about that anyway. Moses agreed on one condition. Fighting men, Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh, crossed Jordan with their brothers. And don't go back home to their inheritance until the last a battle is fought. Joshua now remembers that promise once made to the men of Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh. In time of emergency, you make all kinds of promises that they're easy to forget when the danger is past. All sorts of rash vows when defeat is staring you in the face. And then brush them aside when the peril no longer threatens. Joshua keeps the promise. Joshua is the man of his word. That's why the people will listen to him. He is a leader whom they trust. Later on, there's a touching scene. When Joshua musters the troops out and sends them home, The last division to be discharged are the soldiers of Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh. Joshua praised them for serving long and for serving well, and then sent them back to their homes beyond Jordan with God's choicest blessing. The other exception was this: to Levi there shall be no inheritance given, for the Lord is the God of Israel, is their inheritance, as he said. Every single tribe was to receive part of the spoil, a share in the land, except that tribe set aside to serve the Lord. They were not to be encumbered with any worldly business. They were to give full time and attention to their ministry. We don't remember it today anymore, but your forefathers, when they came to their shore, knew the tragedy of a secular clergy, a church where the workers wheel and deal, specialists in finance, expert in pleading for money instead of for souls, administrators of the almighty dollar instead of the gospel of Christ. That did not mean that Levi had no inheritance. God was their inheritance. The eternal Lord was their portion. They taught others to believe that. Now God will compel them to believe that themselves. That's their share. They hold the grace of God before the people. And then they are to live of the grace of God in the people. And if they wreck the religion, they're undermining their own support. And if I were you people, I would never let the game be played any other way. And if your called workers don't like the game, tell them to find another. There is one plain lesson, however, lying right on the surface of this chapter: that God wanted his people to share in the promised land. God never intended that life be all battle and conflict without risk, without reward. The toil and the struggle, that's part of it. But so is the promised rest and the peace. That's part of it too. We Christians have a difficult time with the subject of reward. When we speak of reward, it always sounds like we earned it. Yes, I deserve it. Or that we're more righteous than anybody else. Now, the gift of God is eternal life, the Bible says. And the gift of God is just that, a gift, no strings attached. But the fact remains, there still is such a thing as a reward. Only God cares that you enjoy one day of Sabbath rest in the hurly-burly of your daily living. He knows how discouraged you become if you never see the fruit of your labor. Jesus surely spoke of sacrifice and self-denial and the cross you must carry to follow him. But Jesus just as surely cared that you not be embittered, broken, unhappy followers. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, he said, and I will give you rest. You know, that's part of it. It is God who taught us that after the sweat of our brow comes the harvest. After the pain and labor of travail comes the birth of a little child. And after the good fight of faith is fought, comes the crown of eternal life. Amen. The peace of God which passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.